Matt, thanks so much for joining me here today.
Thanks for having me.
You have a really interesting background, and you actually have some personal reasons for becoming involved with rare disease research. Can you tell me a little bit about your amazing story?
Yeah, absolutely. So we were kind of thrust into this, as most people are, unexpectedly. My wife and I had a daughter here at Stanford, Grace. She's now 5 and a half, and we knew pretty much right away that something was wrong. She was sent to the NICU for about 3 weeks. And at the end of the NICU stay, her liver function tests elevated, and that kind of opened up Pandora's box, where it was a genetic issue, something that was ultra rare. And so it took us about 3 years. We were very lucky to find a diagnosis that fast.
But you didn't know for 3 years what your daughter
yeah,
had.
Yeah, exactly.
That must have been just incredibly harrowing.
Yeah, I mean, and really, if you talk to anybody that's dealing with a rare disease, getting a diagnosis, even if you can't do anything about it, is significant. And it's really important to kind of have something to hang your hat on and say, this is what we're fighting.
Right. You can get information about prognosis as well as treatment.
Exactly. And if there is really no prognosis or treatment, then assemble the troops that can help you answer those questions or develop a cure.
So how's your daughter doing today?
She's good. She's very, very happy. She's stable. She does have severe problems with her brain, liver, eyes and muscle, but she knows what's going on around her. I say that the lights are on, but no one's answering the door, and so that's what we're trying to work on now, is to develop a drug or therapy that can open that door.
And tell me a little bit about your journey to do that.
So my background is a Silicon Valley entrepreneur. I've been involved in starting and running 3 different startups, and so we take a lot of the lessons from that to assemble the very best lean and efficient team of subject matter experts. I call it like a Manhattan Project light. So we're taking various experts from around the world, piecing them together, making them work together in a very flat, open structure akin to a Silicon Valley startup.
Do you think that medicine and medical research has something to learn from this kind of Silicon Valley approach?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I kind of preach this on a daily basis, that medicine and science is typically cutting edge, but also slow to change from the sort of the hierarchy structure and organizational behavior. Mm-hmm. And so what we're trying to do with our team in particular is to break down some of those traditional barriers. We have a very business-like approach with objectives and milestones, quarterly check-ins, frequent lab visits, but it's actually welcomed by the researchers. They're not defensive about it. They see it as a way to accelerate the research and work with other A-plus talent. That's the thing, is A-plus talent wants to be with A-plus talent, which is very true in Silicon Valley. It makes it a unique place.
So you actually started a foundation in your daughter's name for this.
Yeah, exactly, which, it's a sensitive topic, because, certain people will say, you're naming a particular foundation after your daughter. In our world, we felt like a lot of the funding was going to come because of a personal connection. No one knows what NGLY1 is. It happens to be a very important gene, but it means nothing to, 99.99%
right.
of the public.
They've never heard of it, never had to deal with it personally.
Exactly, so making a personal connection with, a patient that it's actually severely affected by it, and then just kind of trying to motivate the troops to, these are our customers, this is who we're working long hours and weekends to help.
Have you heard from other parents who have children with rare diseases that have worked with your foundation?
Yeah, and we borrow heavily from other rare disease advocates. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think, pioneers like Brad Margus or John Crowley have been really influential in how we run our foundation and our mission. And we're now starting to get like a new wave, sort of the folks that are now coming after us, trying to leverage and borrow the model that we've utilized, and how can they replicate that, expand upon it, make it better, because of course it's not perfect, but it is it's a good beachhead that we hope other people will copy and leverage.
Is the goal of the foundation searching for sort of awareness, cure, treatment, all of the above?
Yeah, no, it's pure and simple. It is to develop a cure. And, to say that, we want to develop a cure, there's not very many cures out there in the world for anything, common or rare. But, and that, of course, ruffles some traditional feathers within medicine and science. It's hard to develop a cure. Maybe you should just develop a treatment and reduce some of the symptoms. But we really are going for a moonshot here. We want to cure. These kids will never be normal. We don't expect them to be, professional athletes or, astronauts, mm-hmm. or, run for the presidency. But we want them to have basic things. They can bathe themselves, dress themselves, feed themselves. Maybe they can hold a basic job, bagging groceries or being a greeter at like Walmart or things like that, something that gives them some independence and meaning in their life. And so that really is the sole purpose of the foundation, is to fund research to develop a cure.
And that's just a tremendous story, and you are obviously very dedicated to the cause. Thank you so much for speaking with me.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.